is that only 2% of the surface of the planet, 50% of the population, actually a little bit over 50% now, 75% of energy consumption, 80% of CO2 emissions. So we ask ourselves, what if we start monitoring the infrastructure using all of this data about vibration that we can collect just in our pockets, thanks to the phones we have, to the smartphones we have. And so we started doing this on a well-known bridge on the Golden Gate. Why the Golden Gate? Well, because the Golden Gate is very well known and understood. People have collected data from the bridge for decades. So we got very good ground truth. We know, you know, exactly how it behaves, so we can see if the data we collect corresponds to the data we have already about the bridge. We collected enough data. You see here the raw data we collected from the accelerometer. This is actually from the iPhone, not from the car, but you know, it would be the same from the car. We collected from the car and the different smartphones, but it looks like this. And then if you analyze it, well, it turns out you can actually detect the key frequencies of vibration of the bridge. So what we are doing now is actually scale this up, use data such as this data from tens of thousands of apps in order to monitor the infrastructure of entire cities or countries. We're working on this with Uber in the United States. We're working on this with Allianz, the German insurer. And again, getting data from, you know, tens of thousands of smartphones and using it and seeing how well we can predict how different, you know, thousands of bridges vibrate and the status of thousands of bridges across different cities in an entire European country, as I was saying. This is a way to at a very, very low cost. Here we are talking about, before we said, you know, $500,000 per year per bridge. Here with a few million dollars, you could actually monitor thousands of bridges across the whole country and tens of thousands of bridges potentially. And then if you see something that doesn't look right, then there you can decide to go and install more sensors and see what is going on, and then do that in a focused way. So again, how data, again, the story here is how we can use data to create like a digital twin of the city, in this case, even of more than the city, like an entire region or country. And then we analyze the digital twin with different tools, with artificial intelligence, in other ways, like you saw here. And then by analyzing the twin, we can better understand what's going on in physical space and also be prepared, you know, be more resilient, be prepared for possible failures and so on. We buy cars and then don't use them. We buy cars and use them on average 5% of the time. 95% of the time, not only they're not used, but actually they use, you know, a lot of space in our cities. They are parked somewhere, as you see. And so what we've been doing is work in Singapore with our lab in Singapore, mathematically, with a recent paper just came out, looking at how we could reduce the number of parking spaces if we use self-driving cars. The reasons that the self-driving car can give you a lift when you go to the office in the morning, and then can give a lift to somebody else in your family or to anybody else in the city. So instead of being parked, it can still be used in the course of the day. And so based on analysis, if you move to a self-driving car paradigm, in Singapore, we could reduce today's parking spaces, 1.4 million more or less, to around 400,000, reducing by 70 or even 80%. When we design something today in our office, we design something with a life of 50 or 100 years. But we know the technology might change in 5 or 10 years. And you know, how can you reconcile those two scales? And we think that one way to do that, to build resilience in our designs, is actually to make them compatible with different futures. And here we'll give you a little example, is about the parking space, as I was saying. So based on today's regulation, we had to put a lot of parking for this giant skyscraper in Singapore. But then we said, well, let's design it in a different way. So we designed the parking, like you see here, the distance, the floor to ceiling height is a bit more. It doesn't cost you much more. It's actually higher floor to ceiling height. Then the structure we did in a slightly different way. So we made it more flexible inside so we can actually tomorrow go and carve out different pieces. And so the idea is that this is the parking, but tomorrow, if we don't need all the space, we can turn it into other functions such as this one or this one. And again, you know, I want to share this with you because that's more and more the case. You know, what we design, what we build, what is made of atoms has a lot of inertia. We still live today in buildings designed and built like 2,000 years ago. In Europe, there's buildings in Rome or in Split, you know, that were designed at Roman times, and people still inhabit them. But at the same time, the way of living is changing very, very fast. If you believe Tom Friedman, you know, it's that progression, that rate of change is increasing, the speed of change is increasing. And how do we cope with that? And I think, you know, an important thing is that the designs we do should have in them the capability to be future-proof, to be compatible with different futures.